If you've ever engaged in a discussion on cosmology and space exploration with the average person, a common question that comes up is, what does anything that happens way out in the far reaches of space have to do with my life on Earth? Well, it's always been the position of the chief science advisor to the Thunderbolts Project, Wal Thornhill, that any coherent cosmology must include meaningful insights into the nature and origins of life and consciousness. As you know if you follow this channel, in the last year, we began the series The Electricity of Life with Alex Fertier, which discusses things such as, for instance, the essential role of electricity in nature, like the electrical interactions between bees and flowers, and the recent discovery that DNA conducts electricity. And a lot of these concepts become more mainstream with each passing year. In fact, a number of scientific papers have been published on the role of electric fields in the regeneration and healing of wounds. And just in the last week or so, a very interesting report was published on the use of cold plasma to treat non-healing wounds, such as those found in the elderly or those with diabetes. Well, today we're going to be presenting an interview with a guest on a very different kind of subject than we've normally presented on this channel. It was in fact Wal Thornhill who brought the Thunderbolts Project's attention to the work of a researcher and author by the name of Eileen Day McKusick. And Eileen is the originator of an unconventional therapeutic method called Biofield Tuning. This practice is based on the concept that the body is surrounded by a so-called biomagnetic field. And this field produces sound waves, which can act as indicators of a dysfunction or injury or illness in the body. Before we present Eileen's interview, we asked Wal Thornhill to provide a brief introduction and to explain the genesis of his own interest in Eileen's work.
Eileen McKusick first got in touch with me in 2010 and asked me questions about the electric universe. Eileen explained that she was a self-taught sound therapist who had been using tuning forks therapeutically since 1996. Over the last few years, as a result of accidental discoveries, she started working up to 6 feet off the body in what she called the body's energy field. And she discovered that sound waves interact with the field in several ways. The overtones appear to reflect, in a sonar or ultrasound kind of way, the information embedded in the field. And for some odd reason, she said, she's able to understand and translate this information. And not so long ago, she started wondering exactly what it was she was working with. Is it electromagnetism? What exactly is happening? Eileen said that she got into the subject because she had bought her son a few science books for his 12th birthday. And after reading through them, he said at dinner time, "Did you know there's a fourth state of matter called plasma?" He was very surprised he hadn't learnt about it in school. Eileen decided to look it up on the internet and learn about it. She came across information that Russian researchers in the 1970s declared the human energy field a bioplasma. Eileen, I found, is an inveterate researcher, and so it was that she came upon the electric universe. It seemed no time at all before Eileen was giving presentations and including the electric universe. So I was not surprised at EU 2016 when Eileen told her audience that her work was to be researched scientifically. I think it quite possible that the electric universe may provide a means of understanding this research.
So in 1996, I had a small massage therapy practice. It was sort of a hobby. I actually owned a very busy restaurant, and holistic therapies and science and spirituality, human potential, were all sort of hobbies of mine. And I was doing massage just, you know, once in a while, but I was really interested in research, and I've always been inquisitive and curious about how things work and always have a stack of books on my bedside table. And I had been reading about the use of color and sound and music in healing. And this was after I had discovered quantum physics that says, you know, everything is vibration. And I remember thinking, well, if everything is fundamentally vibration, if stuff is an artifact of our perception and our nervous system, then treating vibration with vibration, since I'm vibration, seems very logical. And so I read, there wasn't a lot. It was the mid-90s, so there wasn't an awful lot of information out there. But I read what I could find, and then I came across a set of tuning forks for healing in a catalog. So I just got them on impulse, and I started experimenting with them, with people that I felt comfortable enough to say, can you be a guinea pig? And I noticed right off the bat that they didn't behave the way I thought they were going to. I thought that if you activated a tuning fork and held it over someone's body, it was just going to present an objective tone. It was going to be an input to their system. But what I found was that it actually ended up being a conversation between the sounds coming out of the body that, you know, that we don't hear, but that are definitely coming out of the body. Like, everything in the body is in motion, and everything in motion makes waves, and waves propagate. So just like when people get in like an EKG or an EEG, they've got sensors on their skin that are reading, the vibrations being produced in the body. But those waves don't stop at the skin. You know, they keep going off the body. And so what I discovered was that the overtones and the undertones, the inaudible parts of the tuning fork, seem to intersect and even like broadcast the waves coming off the body. So like if somebody had pain in a particular area and I held the tuning fork over that area, it would sound really sharp, or sometimes it would sound full of static. But I also discovered that if I kept on introducing the tuning fork to the area where there was noise, that after a little while, it just wouldn't sound noisy anymore. It would sound kind of harmonious. And then the person would come back the next week and say to me, all that pain in my shoulder went away. That sound thing was really cool. Do that again. And so in pretty short order, my massage practice morphed into a sound therapy practice. And I just developed this little, you know, method of using tuning forks over people, finding areas that were noisy and hanging out there until they stopped being noisy. And then, you know, people would feel better. It was so simple and elegant and curious. I also discovered that I could actually seem to like move stuff around with the tuning fork. So for example, I might find an area where if I held the tuning fork in it, the fork would get really loud. And I was working in what's called the chakra system, which is the hypothesis that our subtle body has these vortices of information and energy flow at very specific points along the spine. And they happen to correspond with areas where we actually have nerve clusters in our physiology. So I was using specific tuning forks for specific chakras, basically, you know, tuning people's chakras, which you can imagine when I was telling people in Connecticut in the 90s that I was using tuning forks to tune people's chakras, what kind of response I got to that. And it was kind of embarrassing to tell people, because there's something about when you say tuning forks and sound healing and chakras that, you know, skeptics just really put walls up. And I'm very logical by nature, and I really didn't like being perceived that way. So over the years, I've gone off on a kind of scientific and academic exploration to try to find language and laws of physics that would explain the phenomenon that I was encountering with my tuning forks. So what I was saying is that I would find these loud spots, and I discovered that I could actually drag these loud spots around. And so if I found one off someone's left hip, you know, sitting over someone's left hip, I could use the tuning fork to sort of hook in to the loud spot, and then I could drag it to the center midline of the body where there was supposedly a chakra, and I could put it there, and then it wouldn't sound loud over the hip anymore. It would sound loud over the chakra, the energy center. If it doesn't mean loud anywhere, I figured it should be, you know, where there's supposed to be a center. So I developed this method of basically what I call the click, drag, and drop, of finding these loud spots and bringing them to the chakras. And then the chakras would sound louder. And people always said the same thing. I feel lighter. I feel brighter. I feel clearer. My pain is gone. My anxiety is diminished. It was the same sort of, you know, predictable outcomes that happened from this. So I did it as a hobby for 10 years. And then one day I accidentally discovered a loud spot 3 feet off of someone's body. And when I moved it to center, which felt very curious because I'd only been like making the move little distances up to that point, the person experienced a very dramatic outcome to an issue that she'd been struggling with and no one had been able to help. And so that got me really curious about the area off the body. And I started exploring that. And what emerged from that is something that I call the Biofield Anatomy Map. And it's essentially the discovery and the hypothesis that our memories, rather than solely being stored in our brain, appear to be stored in standing waves in the atmosphere around our body. And I've come to hypothesize that this is a diffuse magnetic plasma or a bioplasma, and that our memories are vibrationally and magnetically encoded in this field. And I've discovered that the field has a very specific anatomy, meaning that every time we feel a particular emotion, it has a particular frequency signature or wavelength, and that that wavelength exists at a very specific region within this field. For example, the left side of the heart appears to hold all of our stories and our experiences every time we've ever felt sad. So I can start at the outer edge of your field, which seems to me to be bounded by a membrane that has a higher level of charge in it. When I pass a tuning fork through this membrane that's maybe 5 feet off the body, there appears to be about a 2-inch region where there's a greater amount of charge, and that seems to define the outer boundary of a person's field or their magnetic bubble. And that area holds the information of their gestation and then their birth. And then from there in towards the body, it's like going through a person's lifeline or timeline of every single experience they've ever had, which seems to be encoded in this area. And when we experience a trauma, it produces chaotic waveforms. So any history of memory that you have, a car accidents, parents dying, moving when you're 14, like all these things are traumas that create these chaotic waveforms in your field, in your nervous system. And with a tuning fork, we can find them, we can identify them based on where they're falling in the field, the age that it happened, the emotions and things that were involved. So we can identify them. But then the really curious thing is that when you hold a tuning fork very specifically in this area of dissonance related to a traumatic memory, the body becomes self-aware of its own incoherence and will actually tune itself. Just like a musician, you know, if you're tuning up your guitar, you need someone to give you an E, and you can tune to that and get your instrument in tune. It's the same idea what the body does. It becomes self-aware of its own incoherence and does what seems to me to be like a kind of targeted nervous system relaxation. And it just kind of lets go of the tension that it's holding around that particular trauma. And that can lead to the diminishment of all kinds of things. Pain is just, you know, like an area of tension that's being held in the nervous system. Anxiety, depression, all these things are just patterns and rhythms and flows within this electromagnetic system. And the elegance of this particular method is that we can, you know, determine that your anxiety came from a traumatic birth that happened, you know, below the level of your consciousness. You have no idea why you're always anxious. But it goes, you know, we find it back in this timeline and can shift it at its source. So this has evolved into, you know, over the years, I've been doing it, like I said, since 96. In 2010, I started teaching it to people, and we found that, you know, anybody can learn. Anybody can learn to pick up a tuning fork, strike it, start moving in towards someone from 5 or 6 feet away, read the vibes that are being broadcast from the person's body, held in the field, find these areas of distortion, and just hang out in them until the body basically fixes itself. So I've trained hundreds of people at this point now to do it, and people are integrating it into things like occupational therapy, physical therapy, chiropractic, nursing. I have some naturopaths as well, psychotherapists, music therapists. So it can work as a standalone therapy like I do it, or it can just be integrated into other forms of therapy.